Welcome to worship this morning, especially if this might be your first opportunity here. We try not to think in terms of visitors and members. It's just who the Holy Spirit has called to this moment. So we welcome you to this moment. However, if you are worshiping for the first time, just to let you know, a lot of standing up, a lot of sitting down. Please do not feel obligated. If that's a struggle for you or if you just don't want to, it's fine. Also, we have alcohol and gluten alternatives to the Eucharist, but all are welcome to come join us at our Lord's meal. It's one of those busy mornings. Deep breath. Okay, I ran down the aisle. With that said, I want to thank the InReach folks for the breakfast this morning, for confirmands and Sunday school and all that. We very much appreciate all that. But joys and concerns, oh yeah, things coming up this week. Remember, Wednesday is our Wednesday Lenten Holden Evening Prayer devotions, and that's at 6. We have a meal, kind of a Taco Wednesday. Taco Wednesday. So please join us for that. Also, yeah, and that's at 6, and then Holden Evening Prayer at 7, so please join us for that. Joys or concerns, we continue to keep Rebecca and her family in, that's where they sit. That's why, when I point like that, that's I'm pointing. So Rebecca, who's not with us today, but please remember her in prayers on the loss of Ronnie, and as her life begins to settle, please keep her in prayer. We need to keep Deb in our prayers as she waits to hear about results and dealing with maybe possible surgeries. Please keep, that's Scott's Deb, please keep her in prayer. Yes, Pam. We need to keep Pam as her medical stuff evens out. Please keep her in prayers. Need to keep John, and this is Seeley's John, in prayer. Hernia surgery tomorrow, so please keep him in prayers. Anything else? Pat, yes, please keep Pat, who, yeah, I got it. So please keep Pat in prayer. This is Frank's Pat. She got good news, so she's not going to have like an open heart surgery, but she will have to have a stent later, so please keep her in prayer. I don't normally, people who are with us for the first time, I don't normally do this, so if you're here for the first time, I don't point out visitors. However, we have two Pastor Youngs today. We have Bob, who we all know, and his son Dave, And this is actually going to pop up in the sermon, so it's funny how things work out. I'll just leave that as a cliffhanger. Anyway, so welcome. We're glad you're here this morning. Also, Kinsley is 18 today. Happy birthday. So, happy birthday. Is there any, yeah, who? Lorraine. Oh, Lorraine. She's here. So, we're so glad. Hopefully, you're feeling okay. Yeah, I'm glad you're here. I kind of missed, I'm glad you pointed that out. I'm glad you're here. Any other joys and concerns? If not, I need to say this to myself. Let us take a second to focus our hearts and minds as we prepare to come into our Lord's presence.
Thank you.
Please stand as you are able. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who writes the law on our hearts, who draws all people together through Jesus. Held in God's mercy, let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Holy God,
we confess that we are caught in snares of sin and cannot break free. We hoard resources while our neighbors are hungry and cold. We speak in ways that silence others. We are silent when we should speak up. We keep score in our hearts. We let hurts grow into hatred. For all these things that we present only you know, forgive us.
Here is a flood of grace. Out of love for the whole world, God draws near to us, breaks every snare of sin, washes away our wrongs, and restores the promise of life through Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Holy God, through your Son, you have called us to live faithfully and act courageously. Keep us steadfast in your covenant of grace and teach us the wisdom that comes only through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated. Can the children come forward at this time? Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Hey, man. How are you? Good morning. Let me back up a little bit. So, I'm going to ask you a question. Yeah, I'll move my feet. How about that? Let me ask you a question. How many of you go to any kind of school? Who here doesn't go to school? I don't go to school. But you're still going to school, aren't you? Got it? Okay, so I want you to think about either at home or at the school. I want you to think about who the most important person at the school, who has all the power? The principal. That's not true. Huh? Your math teacher? Not true either. There's even a boss above the principal called the owner. Well, yeah, really they're the owners, but anyway. What about there's a person called a superintendent. And guess what? They're not the most important. You know who the most important person or people? You are the most important. You know when they decide what they need to do? You know how they decide? What do you need?
God.
Right? God's, yeah, that's right. Not this time, but yes. Yes, God is always the answer. Right? So have you ever thought about that? You are the most important person. The school does not exist without you. But guess what happens sometimes? We forget that. We do. We turn it, politics, and we think the principal's the most important person. No offense to the principal. Right? Right? We think that, but that's not true. We forget that who's the most important people? The students, right? You set the agenda. You tell them what they need to teach, right? But I think sometimes we forget that. It's so they can hear me. It makes me loud, right? Why do you think I need to have that? Because they need to hear what I say. Right, so see all these people. They are part of this church. What do you think? Who's the most important person in this church? Who's that? God. There you go. Right, Jesus. Right. I think sometimes we forget that. Right. Do you know what? You know what these people will sometimes say? I didn't really get anything out of the sermon. You know why they say that? Because they. You don't like the rising when he comes back? Oh, okay. That's something. We'll need to talk, right? Yeah. Well, was he? Golly, so many theological questions in the children's sermon. You're good. That's right. That's right. You're getting there. Okay. So sometimes we forget that we're not here for us. We're here for God and our neighbor, right? And sometimes we have to remember that, right? So let's pray. Dear Lord, remind us of what is most important. And dear Lord, help us to remember what is most important. And forgive us when we don't remember it and we forget it. It is about you and your love and your mercy. We pray in your holy name. Amen. Oh, it is noisy offering day. No, it's not. Yeah, that's right, because it's the first Sunday. And we are giving to, Lexington Mills on Wheels. So go, you can, who wants to go to the choir? Go get married. Okay, Simon. Good work. Wait just a second. Wait, Reagan. Felix, how'd you do, Felix? Not so bad. Let's give thanks. Dear Lord, we give you thanks for this. Remind us of your gifts and use these things to help Lexington Meals on Wheels. We pray in your holy name. Amen. Oh, sorry, Jaden. Thank you.
Our first reading is from Exodus chapter 20. God spoke all these words. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You have shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol, whether in the form of anything that is in heaven above, or that is on earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord, your God, am a jealous God, punishing children for the iniquity of their parents, to the third and the fourth generations of those who reject me, but showing steadfast love to the thousandth generation of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not make wrongful use of the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not acquit anyone who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. You shall not do any work. You, your son or daughter, your male or female slave, your livestock, or the alien resident in your towns. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that is in them, but rested the seventh day. Therefore, the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and consecrated it. Honor your father and your mother, so that your days may be long in the land of the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or male or female slave, or ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm 19, read responsively. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the sky proclaims its maker's handiwork. Although they have no words or language, and their voices are not heard,
their sound has gone out to all lands, and their message to the ends of the world, where God has pitched his tent for the sun.
It comes forth like a bridegroom out of his chamber. It rejoices like a champion to run its course.
It goes forth from the uttermost edge.
The teaching of the Lord is perfect and revives the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure and gives wisdom to the simple.
The statutes of the Lord are just and rejoice the heart. The commandment of the Lord is clear and gives life to the eyes.
The fear of the Lord is clean and endures forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether.
More to be desired are they than more than the month of my world, sweeter far than honey in the comb.
By them also is your servant enlightened, and in keeping them there is great reward.
Who can detect one's own offenses? Cleanse me from my secret faults.
Above all, keep your servant from presumptuous sins. Let them not get dominion over me. Then shall I be whole and sound, and innocent of a great offense.
Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer.
Our second reading is from 1 Corinthians chapter 1. The message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, But to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will throw. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, God decided through the foolishness of our proclamation to save those who believe. For Jews demand signs and Greeks desire wisdom, but we proclaim Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those who are the called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. For God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom, and God's weakness is stronger than human strength. The word of the God, of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the second chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
The Passover of the Jews was near, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and the money changers seated at their tables. Making a whip of cords, he drove all of them out of the temple, both the sheep and the cattle. He also poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. He told those who were selling the doves, "Take these things out of here. Stop making my Father's house a marketplace." His disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." The Jews then said to him, "What sign can you show us for doing this?" And Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews then said, "This temple has been under construction for 46 years, and you will raise it up in 3 days?" But he was speaking of the temple of his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken, the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, Lord.
Please be seated. So, first thing I want to say is, the whip was for the animals. He drives out the animals with the whip, right? We all have these images of Jesus, you know, whipping people as they're coming out of the temple. That's got to look closer at the text. The other thing is I'm going to do a little defense, and I'm going to this idea of money changing going on. The thing I'm going to kind of point, I want you to see is, the problem is the zeal for it, right? The problem is not the system itself. So what do I mean? So we have this process, we have this country that has been invaded by another country. So we have this new set of money, it's Roman money. But we can't buy our offerings with Roman money. That's against Levitical law. So we have to change that money, right? We have to change that money from Roman money to Jewish money. And so they offer a service to do that. So then I can go buy my whatever, lamb or dove or whatever. Lots of doves, I would bet. So you have to do that. And of course, the people who are going to provide that service want to be compensated, right? The other thing is this. We think... So the earliest, you know, when David establishes the kingdom, basically the kingdom is sort of Jerusalem. But what has happened over time? That Judaism has expanded. So now all of a sudden it takes a long time. So if I have to go to one central location where the temple is and I have to make my sacrifice there, kind of hard to drag my ox or my sheep or my doves several days or weeks or who knows how long it could take. Maybe it's easier to buy it when I get there. Maybe it's just easier to buy it when I get there. So there are people who provide a service. This sounds almost contemporary, right? People who provide a service. If we want poinsettias, we pay people who provide us a service to have poinsettias or Easter lilies or whatever we need. Right? That's what this is. It's not in and of itself bad. You know, if money changing going, I always think of the Girl Scouts who set up and sell cookies out in the narthex and let's drive them out because, you know, that's not what this is about. What is this about? It's about when the process becomes more important than the reason for doing it in the first place. This is not like, what's wrong with these Jewish people? We've got to be careful as Christians not to think in that fashion. Right? What's uniquely wrong with them? Because are we not guilty of the same thing? When we make all the other things more important than the thing itself, I'm not being completely flip with the school analogy. Think of the politics we have created with public education, not only in the state of North Carolina, but in the world, well, in our country. Right? And we debate. We debate our agendas and our thoughts, and we fight over it. And we forget the point. And I'm sure the teachers and the principals would agree with me on this. Right? We do this all the time. The problem is we get so involved in the process that we forget the point of why we do it. And that's the zeal for my house. Jesus is not mad at the system. He's mad that the system becomes more important than the worship of God in the temple. It is more important to make your money and to sell your animals than the reason you do it at all. And here's the other thing. Something is happening at this moment. This, in the Gospel of John, it's a theological point being made. So in the Gospel of John, this happens at the, if you look at the text, the second chapter. This happens at the beginning of the story. In the other Gospels, this happens the week of, before Jesus gets crucified. Because what's going to get you killed? What is going to get you killed? When you challenge somebody's pocketbook, if you challenge the process, that's going to get the authorities' attention. That can get you killed. But in the Gospel of John, the theological point we've just heard in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God. And we go through all that chapter, and what happens to the Word? The Word, capital W Word, Jesus, becomes flesh and dwells amongst us. So guess what Jesus' own person challenges? That God is no longer in this building called the temple, but God is in the world. And the thing I love about the text is I've told you this before. My spirituality and my thoughts, I have a retroactive spirituality. When you hear the stories, I never see God in the story at the time. Where do I see God? It's always after. It's always in retrospect. And did you see that happen in this text? It even says, and the disciples, after the resurrection, remembered. Oh, that's what Jesus is talking about. Destroy not this temple, but destroy this temple, his body. And in 3 days, he will raise it up. The point is, here I am. And we'll hear this over and over in the Gospel of John. I am the resurrection. I am the life. I am the gate. I am the shepherd. I am. That there is no holy place. There is no holy place. Or every place is a holy place because Christ is in the world. That's the power of this text. No longer in temples, but in the world. Christ has risen. Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again. God is unloosed in the world. So it's this process of making money and of interest earned and of animals sold are not in and of themselves bad, but it's when we become more focused on that than the point itself. And Lord knows how easy that is for us, right? I mean, I pick about this all the time, but people will fold their arms and say, I just did not get anything out of the sermon this morning. But maybe the person next to you did, right? I'm sorry to tell you this. I don't provide a commodity. I don't sell you a widget. I preach a gospel. And it's not about you. It's not about you. It's not about your sin. It's not about your salvation. It's about the love of God. My job is to point to the one who loves you more than anybody in the world. Through word, as I preach, as we read, and through sacrament. That's what I do. And even I forget because I rush to see. I wonder how many people showed up Sunday. I wonder what the giving looked like this morning. Right? Sometimes even I forget the point. I think it's about numbers or status or buildings or Harris money in the bank. Do we love God? Do we love neighbor? Do we love self? That's it. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your might. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. That is it. Or did you love the music? Or did you love the sermon? Or did we have the temperature, the right temperature for you? Right? We forget. We forget what we're about. Or we turn it into individual stuff, you know. Are you saved? Are you saved? Are you saved? That's not what we're about. God is the saver. We just point to the one who's done it. And I forget this every day as a pastor. I forget it every day. It's always in retrospect that I look back and I go, oh, it's not in this place. It's in these people. It's in, not in this place. It's in me where the gospel is proclaimed. Right? This is just a really cool place to gather. Right? It is cool. It's pretty. I love it. But it is not the gospel. You're the gospel. I'm the gospel. Sometimes we forget that. Often we forget it. So while we have to come back over and over and remind ourselves and send ourselves back into the world with the proclamation of the good news of our Lord. Christ is risen. Right? Christ is risen. Even during Lent, we can say that. Christ is risen and in the world. And let us be the people of hope in the world. And as I was working on this sermon, I got this crushing news. The seminary where I went to, and Pastor Dave went to, Pastor Bob went to, and Pastor Pless went to, you know, is moving to Hickory. It can't sustain in Columbia anymore, right? Not that I didn't see it coming. We saw it coming. It makes more sense. LR had taken over operations years ago, and it's going to be housed at Lenore Ryan. And I still was crushed. Because if you go to the chapel is a sacred place with this beautiful window as you come in, and you can see it even better from the outside, that represents the Holy Spirit breaking into the world. This huge marble altar and this beautiful font and more windows and this wonderful tracker action organ. And here's what's even harder. That is where, in front of that chapel, where I asked my wife now, asked Tracy to marry me. And that's going to go away. Right? And I'm telling you, all of these graduates, we all are sad. We all saw it coming. But what's going to happen to that chapel? What's going to happen to that window? Will it still be a seminary, or will it just be a divinity school at LR? So somebody put this on Facebook, and we were, you know, everybody was commenting, and I put, you know, I saw this coming, not surprised this happened, but what's going to happen? Is it going to still be a seminary? And what's going to happen to that chapel? And Dave, who shows up this morning, funny how that works out, is on one of the boards, either the seminary board or the LR bar.
The seminary advisory board.
He's on the seminary advisory board, and he basically says, it's going to stay a seminary. It's going to be an LR. And then I asked the real question, but what's going to happen to that chapel? And he said, to be determined later. And I had to think about my sermon for Sunday and say, you know what? What's the good news? The good news is the seminary will be able to continue to train pastors and deacons and church leaders into the future because of the blessing of Lenore Ryan University, who is able to house that, is able to provide that. And what happens to that chapel doesn't really matter. As painful as it is for me to say that, it doesn't really matter. Because what matters? I was blessed to go there. Pastor Pless was blessed to go there. Pastor Bob and Pastor Dave were blessed to go there. And think of all the people they've touched, just those four pastors. And all the pastors that will come after them, that ministry continues with or without that sacred space, because the ministry is with the people and in the world. Right? And that's what matters. Ooh, still hurts, right? Because sometimes we lose perspective. What matters? And I ask you this all the time, and I'll ask again. If First Lutheran Church just dries up and blows away tomorrow, what difference would it make? What difference would it make? The answer to that question is what matters. Are people fed? Are people welcomed? Are people loved? Right? Not, look at the pretty glass. It's pretty, but are people welcomed? Are people loved? That's what matters. And do we feed the poor? That's what matters to Lexington. And this is the Son. Christ is in the world. Christ is in you. Christ is in us. Let the world know it, because that's what matters. Sacred places are great, right? But what matters? Amen. God has made us his people through our baptism in Christ, living together in trust and hope. Let us confess our faith.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, the Holy Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Trusting in God's promise to reconcile all things, let us pray for the church, the well-being of creation, and a world in need. You alone are God. We thank you for the gift of Sabbath rest. Awaken the church to the mystery of your presence and give us glad hearts as we receive the good news of your deliverance. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You renew creation. Drive out those who would make the earth a marketplace. Protect rainforest, mountaintops, oceans, and wilderness areas from commercial exploitation. Unite nations, policymakers, and businesses in efforts to reduce carbon emissions. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You judge the nations. We pray for an end to war and strife in every land. We especially continue to pray for the war in the Holy Land and the Ukraine. Strengthen international efforts to negotiate peace and provide humanitarian aid to the people fleeing from conflict. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You abide with your people. Sustain any in this community undergoing life transitions, marriage, divorce, childbirth, adoption, moving, graduation, employment change, or death in the family. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You bring healing and hope. We give thanks for physicians, nurses, researchers, therapists, and public health workers who prevent and treat illness. We pray for any who are sick. We especially pray for Nathan and Jeff, Rebecca, John, Pastor Bob, Deb, Tracy, Norma, Margie, Mickey, Bob and Sandy, Dan, Phil, Laura, Roy and Gracie, Lee, Willie Ruth, and Pauletta. Be with those on our prayer list, for those we name silently in our hearts, or for those we now name aloud. Hear us, O God. You bring life from death. We remember our loved ones who have died, confident that they have new life in you. We especially continue to lift up the spirit of Ronnie Moretz. May we trust that nothing can separate us from your love. Hear us, O God.
Accompany us on our journey, God of grace, and receive the prayers of our hearts through Christ, Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
Jesus, you are the bread of life and the host of this meal.
Bless these gifts that we have gathered that all people may know your goodness. Feed us not only with this holy food, but with hunger for justice and peace. We pray this in your name. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks.
It is indeed right and salutary that we should at all times and in all places offer thanks and praise to you, O Lord, Holy Father, through Christ our Lord. You bid your people cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Paschal feast. Renew our zeal in faith and life, and bring us to the fullness of grace that belongs to the children of God. And so with the church on earth and the host of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, mighty, and merciful Lord, heaven and earth are full of your glory. In great love you sent us, Jesus, your Son, who reached out to heal the sick and suffering, who preached good news to the poor, and who on the cross opened his arms to all. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks. He broke it, and he gave it to his disciples to eat, saying, "This is my body, given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out your Holy Spirit, that by this holy communion we may know the unity we share with all your people in the body of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Through him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor are yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
Remember us in your kingdom, O God, and teach us to pray. Bread for the journey, a feast for hungry hearts. Come.
Thanks be to God.
May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the gift of his body and blood strengthen, keep, and unite us now and forever.
Amen.
Generous God,
at his table we have tasted your immeasurable grace, that grains of wheat are gathered into one bread. Now make us one loaf to feed the world. In the name of Jesus, the bread of life. Amen.
Eternal God, whose glory is revealed in the crucified and risen Lord, bless those who go forth to share your word and sacrament with our sisters and brothers who are unable to be with us today. In your loving care, nourish and strengthen those to whom we bring this communion in the body and blood of your Son, that we may all feast upon your abundant love made known in Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Beloved, we are God's own people, holy, washed, renewed. God bless you and keep you, shower you with mercy, fill you with courage, and give you peace. Amen.
Thank you.
Go in peace, share your bread.
Thanks be to God.